do this. Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of The VOD Squad, the show where we talk about streaming devices, content, providers, whether or not streaming is actually a thing. And yes, seriously, we talked about that last week, if you weren't here. But hey, I am Clyde. Today I am joined by Matthew Ross.
Hello.
Jimmy Trammell.
Hello, everybody.
And there's a guy, I think we remember him, is Mike, right? Michael Aston?
Hello, everybody.
You're back.
I'm back.
You made it.
It's only been a couple of weeks.
That's
all right.
I think they call that a sabbatical, right?
2 weeks is a sabbatical?
Something like that.
Wow, you need to get some more PTO.
Oh, no, you're telling me. Yeah, definitely. Now, glad to have you back. Glad to have everybody. Yeah, we've got a pretty full chat room tonight, so hopefully.
Don't know why.
I know. I mean, we're not even on channel one.
I know.
Oh, maybe that's the key. We're back off of channel one, and now there's people in the chat again.
Oh, okay. So. Is that the thing? Okay. How you doing, Clyde? Did you have a good week?
Oh yeah, it's not been too bad.
Okay.
But it's only Wednesday.
It's got time to go downhill.
Absolutely. But we will get to the movie party on Saturday and everything will be good no matter what.
Very cool.
So
you guys decide on the movie yet?
Yeah, absolutely. It is August. We're doing a spider theme, so we're starting out with Big Ass Spider and potentially more. But Big Ass Spider is a go.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Try to tune in on this one. This sounds good.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, well, I guess, should we get into some of this news? We are full packed this week.
Well, we had a bunch of news to kind of slide in this week. We're going to start with what looks like might be breaking news.
Can I sneak in here before we start on the news?
Oh, man,
so,
yeah.
Talking about last week's show, you mentioned it in the intro, right? We talked about, is cord cutting a thing? And so I have to say, it is definitely a thing. Even Consumer Reports agrees. They're saying how to cut the cord right on the top.
See, you know, I mean, that right there is a glowing endorsement because Consumer Reports is the magazine that grandparents read. So if I'm not saying that is a bad thing because my grandpa's the one that introduced me to Consumer Reports. Yeah. But the fact that they thought it was important enough to put it into something that old people are going to read, then it must be, you know, there must be something to it, right?
Without going into it, I do want to mention that I read it. It was interesting. I thought there was some value in there. However, I will say it's $6.99 cover price. We have already provided you in the shows that we have on YouTube every single piece of information that is in there. So, just saying.
So, I mean, you're saying is you could go out and spend $7 or
dead trees.
You could go over to YouTube for the low, low price of a subscription, which is just a click and a couple likes and maybe find it for yourself. Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
All right. That sounds like a deal.
That is a deal.
All right. Well, should we move on?
Okay. Yeah, back on the rails. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, you come back, first week back, and then you throw everything out the window.
Okay. Well, just want to start off with saying that this looks like it could be not real news. I don't know. It just happened a few minutes ago. I just happened to see this and put it up. CBS looks like they might be delaying Star Trek Discovery And they're looking to do that possibly because they're trying to maintain the quality of the show. Now, to me, this is a big deal because this is the streaming service's, you know, star show. This is the only reason why I would consider going to CBS All Access. And it's supposedly, according to this, a 9-month delay.
Well, they already delayed it like 9 months.
I know. It was supposed to come out in January.
I feel deja vu here.
You think this is...
I feel like we've heard this story.
You think this is just like a replaying of the... it might be. This might be somebody else. The same story just repeated again. Might be just like...
I was going to say, otherwise, I mean, the first time there was like production issues, right? Or it wasn't ready, whatever. But this time, they were going to be premiering up ahead or up against the new Seth MacFarlane show.
Right.
And I don't know. You think they're scared of that?
No, because everybody should not be scared of that.
The thing is,
of that would be so bad.
Well, the reason I ask that is because everybody can watch the Seth MacFarlane show for free, whereas you can only watch the CBS show if you pay for a service.
Well, I don't think that they would go into it afraid that they would lose potential. That people wouldn't sign up because of the Seth MacFarlane show being another option. I think that they should be afraid, even if they aren't, of the possibility that people will watch both because one is free and they'll realize that the Seth MacFarlane show is more enjoyable overall.
I was going to say, how bad would that be if they both premiered at the same time and the Seth MacFarlane one was just better? I mean, a different kind of better, but
yeah,
I mean, they're not like, it's obviously apples and like onions, you know, but
I've seen previews for both. And I would say I'm kind of more excited for the Seth MacFarlane show.
I am too. I'm really.
I think I'm with you there, Mike, you know, and, you know, I mean, if you think about it, I mean, didn't most people watch Star Wars also watch Spaceballs as well?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. Well, and that was the thing. I love Spaceballs, but
Spaceballs was an ongoing series, and Star Wars was an ongoing series, and Star Wars was like episodes 1 through 3, and Spaceballs was continued to be as fun and enjoyable as Spaceballs was. You might have a hard time convincing people to keep watching Star Wars and not watching the Spaceballs show. And that, to me, is what I'm seeing here. So that's an apt analogy, in my opinion.
See, and actually, yeah, because I was going to say it works perfectly because when I was a kid, I was introduced to Star Wars through Return of the Jedi, and I went, meh. And then I saw Spaceballs, and I was like, this is the greatest thing in the world. I knew just enough about Star Wars to get the jokes, but I didn't actually have to care about Star Wars, which is kind of where I am right now. Where I know just enough about the Star Trek to get the jokes, but I don't have to care about, you know, the, you know, canon or anything in any way. So, yep.
So if this is a repeat, my mistake, I'm sorry. It looks like it's...
It came out today.
The story came out today, but I don't know if it's that. It did come from Fox News. I know that could be fake news.
I mean, if it's on Fox News, then, you know, I would put some credibility behind that because they're like, hey, guess what? They don't want to go up against our show.
Yeah,
put it out. Get it out there.
That might be true.
So right. I would actually think that would put some credence behind it. So, all right.
Okay. Moving along, Bloomberg is reporting that Facebook is finally getting ready to launch their television shows that you will be able to see streaming on Facebook's homepage. They will be starting their first shows in the middle of August this month. So give it a couple weeks. You're going to start seeing some... Facebook friendly, if you know what that means, shows being available right online. It looks like they're asking for the show producers to produce their turn in their episodes now so they can get them ready for mass distribution.
So this doesn't talk at all about the content, at least that I saw, right? So it says that they brought in some shows, but no idea what they're showing.
Well, they've been talking about this for a while, and they keep saying, it's coming. And then, right. like, months go by, and they say, it's kind of like Star Trek Discovery. It's coming. But,
I expect this to do the same thing of what they've done with almost all the other content. At first, it's going to be not as good as everybody else's, but they will iterate quickly. And with their fast iteration, they will catch up very quickly. And because it's Facebook, they will have so much ground already covered that they will, of course, just kind of take over. I'm afraid of that kind of monopolistic style of maneuvering, which obviously, to me, this is a very big foothold that they have that they can take over with. So you could say goodbye to things like Dailymotion or other, you know, lower end streaming services that will want to do something like this. Twitter, their streaming service could disappear due to something like this. Now, does that mean that they should stay, those other services? Not necessarily. They might suck.
Yeah.
I mean, okay. The competition is good.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I also don't want to see a Hulu suddenly you go, oh, we can't really compete against Facebook kind of thing.
That ain't never going to happen.
Well, you never know.
Well, I mean, there.
That's a ways down the road, at least.
Right, I know. All I'm saying is that I always fear companies that have that kind of power, which Facebook is, flexing their muscles in that way, you know, buying up all the talent, buying up all the shows.
Maybe like Pluto and Acorn and like some of the smaller ones, but not Hulu, because Hulu's backed by the biggest freaking content creators on the planet. So,
I am high too, right?
So.
Yeah.
It's going to be interesting to see what they bring. I mean, no doubt about that, right?
Mm-hmm. As Derpity Do in the chat says, you know, now we can watch psycho people spam food photos. You know what? I'm kind of excited for that aspect. Because when I travel, I will snap pictures of my food only for the only reason that I get to rub it in the faces of my friends who would want to be there. Now I can make them watch me eat it. Absolutely.
Yeah, I pulled that on my last vacation.
Yeah.
Had to take some pictures of my friend's favorite restaurant, me eating at it while he's...
Aww. Oh, I know Mike. Mike had to watch me do that a couple times. All right. Yeah, so Facebook TV.
I could imagine a show like Tasty. Then, so could you imagine a whole Tasty show where the quick, you know, somebody showing how a meal is created?
Oh, I thought you meant Tasty from Orange is the New Black.
No.
Like she would have her own show about food.
That'd be interesting.
Okay. Yeah, maybe.
So in Hulu news, Hulu has yet again grabbed a little bit more of that back catalog. They went ahead and grabbed, after last week's story about them grabbing all the old Fox shows, they've now picked up all the shows that were produced by Warner Brothers TV back in the 90s, which is pretty much everything that's TGIF. You got Mr. Cooper, you've got Family Matters, you got Step by Step, you've got Full House. All those are shows that are going to be available for you to stream on Hulu. And once again, the shows that you love to watch in the 90s will all be available right there.
You know, I really want to see Hanging with Mr. Hooper. You guys remember Mr. Hooper? He ran the general store on Sesame Street, and then he died in the 80s and traumatized all the children. I want to see, they're just hanging out with this dead guy that's still behind the counter.
It's like a permanent weekend at Bernie's.
Yes. He's been there since 1984. No, I mean, see, and the thing is, I keep hearing people talking every week. I see these reports about, wow, Hulu's getting this stuff? And as we've talked about before, this makes perfect sense, and I don't know why they didn't do it sooner, because ABC, NBC, Fox, they are Hulu.
Right.
All of their back catalog should be on Hulu.
Especially, I completely agree.
You know, I mean, because I've been surprised that up to this point, they've been allowing competitors to have, just the unfettered access to certain shows. So yeah, I am completely not surprised that they're pulling everything back, especially with their moves into Live. So I say yeah, good on you, Hulu.
Isn't Fuller House on Netflix?
Yes.
Yes, that's the interesting thing, is that Fuller House.
Go ahead. Yeah, it's just that, like, this is pretty cool for my not my family, but my, like, my niece is the biggest Full House fan in the world. Like, she used to, and probably still does, just watch constant reruns of Full House. That was like anytime she could get in front of a TV that her parents would let her, she was watching reruns of Full House. And so then Fuller House came out and she fell in love with that and watched that.
You know, the thing that makes me smile, though, is I know, or the knowledge that there was someone at Netflix that said, "How rude."
Oh, you had to do it, didn't you?
You got it, dude.
No, no. Stop it. Cut it out.
All right. Oh, this is horrible. Okay, let's go.
We are old anyway.
Yes, we are. Yeah, well. All right, moving forward, we have another channel that's coming to streaming service, just the channel that everybody wants, Hallmark. Actually, there's a lot of people who have really been, I mean, I've had some people around me who said I would pick up this streaming service, but it doesn't have Hallmark, and I would pick up that streaming service, but I really want Hallmark channel. And it's now available on a couple of the channels available out there, but it now looks like that they're going to be moving forward by moving into their own streaming service for a monthly fee. I think there looks like they're going to start at $6 a month, which to me sounds really expensive.
I hope they throw in a couple greeting cards with that.
That'd be nice. Well,
you know, a couple of things I find interesting about this article. One is, you know, Hallmark. I mean, if they're getting into streaming, then streaming really is a thing.
Yeah. You know, there are moms and grandmas out there that love Hallmark.
Oh, absolutely.
So, I mean, yeah, you want to cater to, you got to cater to everybody that's out there that's willing to pay. So mm-hmm. if there's even, if let's say there's only 10 people that are willing to pay for it, hey, those are 10 people that are now giving you money. So
true.
Why not?
My wife and both my wife and my mom enjoy watching a lot of the Hallmark movies. So something that gives them access to that. And in fact, that's been an annoying feature of theirs, that especially of my wife, that she can't get those. They're not available on Hulu. They're not available mm-hmm. on Netflix. Right. She can't watch them on their websites and stuff like that. So that's been an annoyance. And
yeah. Where else are you going to watch that Christmas movie about the oldest daughter from Full House that moved to a like logging community resort place and saved everybody's Christmas? That's actually a real one. I just don't remember what the actual plot was.
that's exactly what it is. You know, my wife likes to watch those feel good movies every Christmas and whatnot, and you know, whatever, that's fine for her. I let her watch that while I go and watch episodes of awesome podcasts or whatever.
And you yeah. know it, and everybody knows whatever makes your wife feel good is good for you. Whatever it takes. Get her in that good mood.
Yeah, I agree. I am happy about this. We will probably pick it up a couple of times a year for a month at a mm-hmm. time or something.
Sure.
Just let her catch up. I think that $6, I agree with you, that seems a little steep for the limited catalog that you're getting.
Yeah.
What you get with other services for close to the same price, like Hulu and Netflix.
Yeah, but you right. know there are going to be thousands of husbands out there that are going to quick hurry up and subscribe to it just so they have the option of being like, "Here, honey, just sit down and watch this."
Yep. I will we'll be talk one in of a those minute. People. I may, like I said, we may not do it every month. We may go off and on as new seasons finish up so she can catch up some seasons or whatever.
Yeah.
But we'll definitely do this sometimes.
All right. Well, welcome, Hallmark.
Oh, man. Hallmark Channel. There are so many people who are going to love that, but I'm not going to be one of them, quite frankly.
Is it funny that Hallmark TV isn't really a Hallmark at all?
Okay.
Never mind.
We're going to move on. Moving from that, we have a report that it looks like DirecTV Now is starting a beta test of their DVR service, which means it's happening. The one feature that they needed in order to actually be something kind of useful, kind of on over the over your cord cutting experience of television service, is finally going to be here. It's finally going to happen. What's taken them so long? This one, well, this feature is the one feature that has held them back, and so we're happy to hear that they're finally moving.
They were really late to the party, you know, more than a year late. So, you know, I'm not surprised that they're just now getting it. The fact that they're getting it now, I think that's still quicker than, you know, like Sling, because Sling was around for what? 2 years now?
Yeah.
Oh, no, no. Just, yeah, I'd say, so, yeah. So,
But still, it's as soon as the first service came out with a DVR, which I believe was PlayStation View, it literally just kind of took off as the best option, as everybody else had to play catch-up at that point. And so everybody has been catching up. You've had YouTube TV that was introduced with it. You've had Sling, which has picked it up. You've had these other little guys that have their DVR features built into them. And DirecTV, they came in with a splash into a very shallow pond. And there have been lots of people with lots of problems. And, of course, the number one thing that people have been saying is, where's my DVR for a feature? Because nobody wants to sit down for appointment television anymore.
Yeah, you know, in the chat, W. Scottis 1 makes the point that if they had done this 7 months ago, he might have stayed with them. To which I respond, you always have the option of going back. Once you leave, you're gone or you have to sign a contract or anything. You can always pop back and check it out, and if you still don't like it, oh well.
That begs an interesting question. When do you think our first one of these big streaming providers is going to say, and you have to have a 6-month contract? When do you think that's going to happen?
That's a scary thought.
I don't even want to speculate. I've had that thought before, and it scares the crap out of me.
Does me as well.
Oh, that will be
I guarantee the prices are going to keep going up. It's when once they hit that point where they can't comfortably raise the price and actually consider keeping people. So that's where the contract's going to come in. You can either pay this $60, $70, or you can pay the $30 a month with a contract.
Yeah, I think if they do introduce that, it would be something like that, right?
I mean, because that's what cable was doing with bundles and stuff like that. And yeah, it'll get there, hopefully not anytime soon, because, yeah.
The one other thing I did like about this article is that they're going to offer the 4K service as well. Mm-hmm. Starting to see more and more guys doing it now. And, I think this year is going to be the year that I actually buy a 4K television.
I almost pulled the trigger on a TCL the other day. The 50-inch Roku one that I keep looking at was $300. I was like, But then I looked at my Plasma and I said, "You're not going anywhere anytime soon." So I don't need to spend $300 on a TV that I have no place to put. So
all right, moving on, we have a story about Discovery purchasing the network called Scripps, which is this network of television channels, which includes such channels such as Food Network and HGTV and the Cooking Channel. This is an amazing purchase of Discovery, which seems right up their alley, quite frankly, because of that's the kind of television that they make. And it's a consolidation of the market, so it makes me wonder what else is going to happen as things move along here. Are we going to have more consolidation from other big providers?
So is The Modern Rogue going to show up on one of the Scripps networks
on HGTV
instead?
Yeah, it's on HGTV.
On HGTV.
The Modern Rogue.
Well, the third of it would be appropriate on the Food Channel, maybe.
Ah.
Right? Anyway, one thing, I think this is interesting because I don't know how this really helps the companies. I mean, this is in the article they talk about. This doesn't solve any of their problems. These companies are very similar. They both are in a market that is very challenging for them at this point in time because they don't have a lot of things that draw them to big payers like cable channels, like sports channels and stuff like that. And they are all, pretty much all of these channels are available on pretty much every service. So I don't know where they really have to go from here, unless by going together, they can create their own subscription service and pull their shows off of Hulu and PlayStation View and Sling TV and stuff like that, and then have a large enough group to create a compelling dedicated subscription service. So that would be the one thing I think might be happening here, is they're saying, hey, well, if we have every single major lifestyle channel, your Discovery channels and all of that, and then your cooking and food and building shows like DIY and HGTV, if we have all of that, then there's a large segment of people that watch this on cable right now that would then have to pay us $6 or $7 a month for just that service, and we would be able to get rid of all of these other subscriptions.
That's an interesting thought of going separated like that.
Yeah. I mean, I think it plays into, you know, the a la carte channels out there and all. I mean, I could see it happening. Is the Travel Channel not part of this group here? I guess they're not, are they?
The Travel Channel is part of Scripps.
It is?
I think so. Did I not read that correctly? I was looking at
this. I'm looking at the article, and it's mentioning all those channels except for the
I don't see it.
I don't see the Travel
Channel. If you go to Scripps Network's actual website, though, it's HGTV, Food Network, Travel Channel, DIY Network, Cooking Channel, Great American Country, TVN, Fine Living, and AFC. I don't know what like the last half of those are, but
yeah. And so yeah, I think you're right, Michael. I think that's probably going to be their play, that maybe they do want to offer a la carte offering of those channels there. But I don't see that they would, just because they do that, that doesn't necessarily mean they have to pull out of the other services as well, right? They could do both.
Yeah, and they definitely would have a better negotiating position to say, look, now you get all of this at once. It's all of your lifestyle-related media. And, you know, your Discovery, your Science, mm-hmm. your, what else is on the Discovery Channel? It's the Discovery Communications. There's a few decent shows on there, or channels. There's a lot of stuff that you probably have never heard of.
I think that isn't Discovery also owned or at least partners with the National Geographic Channel? So
I don't know if that's true or
not. Might be.
So I just looked up AFC, the last channel from the Scripps Network, and I want this channel. It's the Asian Food Network, or Asian Food Channel.
Oh, yeah. I was thinking America's Funniest Something.
America's Funniest Channel?
Yes. Oh, maybe it is. You know, with some of the weird stuff that you get in, like, Asia.
It's true, but I mean, seriously, I want to, you know, I would love to have a channel where it's showing all the different Asian foods and some of the stuff I wouldn't eat, but a lot of stuff I would. It's like that because I love.
That's why everybody used to watch Andrew Zimmern eat around the world.
Yeah. Right.
But those weird foods, they're cool from your couch, not so cool when you're standing there in the market. Flashing back to my time in Hong Kong.
Eat this. Yeah, eat this.
Oh, and the smells. Oh, my God, the smells. But, yeah. Rock on.
All right.
We got to work on our segues.
Okay, well, we're trying. We have a story here from that looks like Apple TV and the Android mobile platform is getting access to Plex's DVR and live streaming service. This is the service where if you can hook up a Silicon Dust or other compatible device to your network or into your computer, your Plex server. You can DVR content and also stream live channels directly to your devices. And it looks like they've added a couple more platforms. There is still no support for the web version of this, though, if you want to watch it on your computer, it's still not there. But they say, as this has been moving along, that they will keep working on making the other platforms work.
It says Android mobile devices, and I could have sworn that this has always been on the mobile devices, that it waited a while for Android TV.
So they started off on Apple iOS,
yeah,
and on the Android TV. And now they're doing the opposite, the Apple TV and the Android devices.
Okay.
And next they're going to go off from there and do the other stuff. I mean, it's an interesting choice.
I use Plex. I've been using Plex for years. I've never used this version of Plex, though, because I only use it to watch stuff that I own local with local copies, so... Rock on.
I considered it because my options for what I can get are very limited, I'm considering buying the kind that works with the cable card and working with my cable company to just get that so I can get my live streaming from that. But
cool.
It seems very cool. I'm very excited about Plex, and this is big news for them. So, last but not least, speaking of big news, is that last week, there was a, like earlier in this week actually, there was a news story about that there was a hack for Game of Thrones.
You mean like a hack in order to like show the show with like nobody has clothes or everybody's got big heads?
No, somebody went and stole the original story is that somebody went ahead and hacked HBO's servers and was able to get information, including the script for at least the next episode of Game of Thrones, which everybody that I heard talk about it said, "Oh well, I'll just watch it next week. No big deal." But it looks it might have been a little bit worse than that.
The most important thing here is this picture is flawlessly executed for this image. The look on her face, she is so concerned about this hack.
Yep,
it is really good.
It seems like the other pieces of information were also stolen. Things like the screenshots of the HBO's internal administration tools, listing employee names and email addresses. Looks like some of the administrators and of the company's purchases on Amazon have been leaked out. A lot of various little pieces of data were stolen. This very large piece of stolen 1.5 terabytes of data, which was stolen.
What one thing back to Mike's point, I just wanted to say, if that is their firewall,
nothing's getting through.
That's how they got in. I mean, while it's deadly, that's not very effective.
Oh, yeah, seems pretty effective to me.
It's pretty though. So hey, you know.
So you think they're trying to motivate them to, you know, do like Netflix and just release all the episodes at once?
They won't do that. HBO is built on the overtime model.
I think my guess, like, if you look at this, and this isn't surprising really as a whole, like, what did they do? Well, they hacked into HBO and they stole a bunch of stuff. Did they actually go in to get Game of Thrones, or did they hack into HBO and happen to find Game of Thrones while they were getting all of this information? Yeah. I mean, this employee details and stuff, typical corporate hack, they just happened to get a little bit of a gem while they were in there and decided, hey, let's release this.
Yeah, I'm going to go with it wasn't targeted other than HBO was targeted. They just got in like a smash and grab and then said, oh, hey, look, but they left lying out on the counter. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, it's not like it wasn't obvious that people were going to try and do stuff because that's what people do. So yeah, something sensitive like that. I do think it might be part of the publicity stunt, because they're right now we what, three episodes in, so we're already halfway through this season. There's only two episodes left. You gotta keep the people excited somehow, right?
Well, this is a half a season, and we'll have another half a season later, so...
Yeah, I think it's next year. I think it's seven episodes this season, and then the other seven.
I thought it was
seven.
Only five.
But I don't know.
I
thought I read it was seven. Okay. I don't know. Maybe it's only five.
But either way,
It's less than a full episode or full season. That's for sure.
Yep. Moral of the story: HBO got hacked. Was anybody surprised? No. Should they have been expecting it? Yeah. HBO, do a better job. Get a better firewall. Dragons don't cut it.
Okay. And I think that is the end of our list of stories.
All right. You know what?
We've made it through the news.
We've got about 20 minutes left. And, you know, as we pointed out earlier in the show, with hanging with Mr. Hooper and all the talk of TGIF, we're old. I know there's probably a few people out there that are either in the chat or will watch this later that'll be like, what are they talking about?
Well, there was an amazing story I happened to come across. It's about this. So the story goes like this. This is a blurb from the Wall Street Journal. Dan Cisco had discovered a technology that allows him to access half a dozen major TV channels completely free. I was just kind of surprised that this technology exists. And Mr. Cisco, 28 years old, said, it's been awesome. It doesn't log out and it doesn't skip. And you know what? It was over-the-air antenna. He just didn't know about it. Basically, the story is pointing out that the kids, the millennials, of this year, of right now, are unaware of free and available services that they can use. And that kind of makes sense, because if you ask me, it's not well, we're not advertising it very well. There's a little bit of talk, like from us, we'll say, hey, go get yourself an antenna, see what you can get. But there's another bit of the story where it seems like there was a bunch of people who said that, oh, Carlos Valeros, 21, who was selling tube-shaped digital antennas at a swap meet in San Diego, was handling them recently, and customers were asking, hey, is this $20 to $25 legal? It can't be legal. You're stealing it over there. Earlier this year, she got an earful from a woman who says she was mad, he recalled. She says, no, you can't live in America for free. What are you talking about? You have to pay for it, apparently. So we're old. We know this stuff. We assume that everybody knows this stuff, and I think it makes sense for us to go ahead and just take a moment and explain to all the young people out there that, you know, here's some of the things that you can do. Here's some of the stuff you probably didn't know if nobody told you. And I wouldn't mind just going over a couple things like about that. First of all, just to hit it over the head. Yes, you can get over the air television for free. It's that paid for but through your tax dollars. Absolutely. Go ahead, put it up antenna, see what you can get. Enjoy your show.
Yeah. See, and we talked about this a while back where I put an actual TV in my kids' room. It had an antenna, so it could get over the air. Mm-hmm. It also had a Roku, or at the time a Fire TV attached to it. Mm-hmm. They never even tried to turn it on. It sat there for like 3 months, and they never once tried to turn it on until I asked them about it, and they said, oh, we can use that? What does it do?
What's it do?
Yeah. You know what I mean? They're like, what does it do? And, or like when we went to, when we were in California last, back in October, they were completely befuddled by the concept of channels. They couldn't figure out how to get... They finally found the channel that Disney XD or regular Disney was on that they wanted to watch. So they wrote down the number. It was like channel 400 or something. That was up in the high desert. And then we went down to San Diego. We got to the hotel room. And one of my daughters says to the other, oh, she pulls out the paper. She says, it's like 420 something. And they're, I just sat there while they're flipping through. Not only does is it not on that channel, but the hotel we're at, they don't even have that many channels.
Right.
But, I mean, yeah. So just a note to those that may not be familiar, content, while it may be available over the antenna in multiple cities, it's not necessarily going to be in the same place.
Right. Yes. I want to do another thing that seems obvious, but you need to be told if you didn't know. Everybody watching a show that's being broadcast to you, whether it's over the air or over cable or however it's being sent to you, you have the right to record it. Mm-hmm. It's being sent to you. You can record it. It's not against the law. It is something that you can go ahead at any time, make a recording, and watch at a different time. They had these things called VCRs back in the day, kind of were cool. Which well,
those were just like giant cassette tapes.
Exactly.
Which is really helpful because they've never heard of cassettes.
Eight-track. What's a cassette? Sorry, 8-track.
What's an 8-track?
Or was it reel-to-reel in a box?
Now you're getting really old.
Reel-to-reel in a box, that's what it is.
No, but there used to be a technology called VCR, which people would use to record a show. You could set up your VCR at this time, turn to that channel number and hit record for half an hour. And then you would come back after, you know, way out. Maybe you were at work while it was recording and you say, oh, let's go turn that show on that I missed. It was the first style of time shifting. So DVR. And you are completely allowed to do this. This was a Supreme Court case, and you can put some of the thanks to being allowed to watch stuff on DVR at any time. That right, you can give some of that to Mr. Rogers. So you can look that up if you're interested.
Yeah, and it's important to note that the VCR has been around, or came out almost 40 years ago, or older, more than 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say 90% of them that are still in use still have a blinking 12 o'clock.
It's the hardest thing to program. It's crazy hard.
But the problem was you couldn't time shift and record if you weren't home if you couldn't set the clock.
Yeah.
Yep. It reminds me, there was a great YouTube series by a YouTube channel called React, and they were kids react videos, like middle schoolers showing them Walkmans for the first time and showing them a original NES and stuff like that. It was pretty funny to watch them. You mean I have to like push this button the whole time until it finally gets to the song I want to listen to?
Linear technology.
Didn't we have a story about this time last year that the final VCR was made and they're no longer in production?
I think it was winter, but yeah, it was months.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. The last people that were making VCR stopped making them.
Yeah. I remember those days. Anything else that we think the kids should know about, you know, their rights and what they can do?
Huh.
I mean,
channels quickly. But unfortunately, you can't flip them too quickly because everything's digital now. So you flip a channel, it's got a wait decode view.
Used to be, it's true right now that all of the various channels are coming to you at the same time over the air. It used to be true as we have cable too. They would actually flood the cable with every single channel on a different frequency, and by changing the channel, you were literally changing the frequency. So you could have, that's why you could have somebody in one room watching one channel and somebody in another room watching another channel. The TVs were just tuned into different frequencies. Nowadays, you need to have something that can actually request upstream, start sending me this stream, essentially, from the internet or from their internal network in order for you to get stuff. But it used to be you could have picture in picture, a little thing where You could actually have like four screens at the same time showing you your shows of what's going on, because all those signals were coming at the same time. So that was a thing. It's not like that anymore unless you're going over the air. It's still technically all coming straight at you. So you can still do the fast click, 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 click there. Although it does take a little bit extra time to decode the digital signal.
Quick question.
Right.
How many had one of these?
I never personally owned one, but I've broken like a dozen.
A VCR rewinder.
Shaped like a car. So that people wouldn't realize that you had a rewinder.
Yeah. Back in the day, you know, Blockbuster would charge an extra charge if you didn't rewind the tape. Absolutely. Remember that?
Because it Hollywood took like a half hour.
No, it didn't.
Yeah. It did take.
If you did it on your VCR, you had to do it at low speed, otherwise you would wear out the VCR. So that's why it would take forever in your VCR. These things sped up the process.
I used to work at a Hollywood Video, and yes, we would rewind them and not charge you.
So. And what happened to Hollywood Video?
It went out first. But maybe it should have been charging those.
See, it was all those late fees and rewind fees that Blockbuster was charging that kept them afloat for that extra year and a half.
Hollywood was better, though. I remember Hollywood.
Oh, yeah.
Fine.
Anything was better than Blockbuster.
Yeah.
All depends on your store. You could probably find a good Blockbuster in several places.
Oh, and Wabbit asks, what is UHF? UHF was a movie by Weird Al Yankovic in the was it the mid 90s or was it the early 90s?
Yeah, early 90s.
Early 90s, yeah.
Yeah. That was a great movie. Everybody should go out and watch it because Weird Al is popular again. Or at least he was a couple weeks ago. He's probably not popular anymore. But yeah, go out and watch it.
UHF has amazing. It is an amazingly funny movie. Absolutely, go watch it. Very weird.
Oh no! But to his thing, yeah, we should specify that in the olden days when you got your TV over the antenna. There was actually two different bands. There was VHF and UHF. They were completely different frequencies. Think of AM and FM radio. They basically had different capabilities. If you don't know what AM and FM radio is, I can't help you with that one. That's not the subject.
Go find a Wikipedia article. Read it up.
Go send an email to Scott Wilkinson. He can explain it to you. But yeah, so you had one, or essentially channel 2 through 13, that was VHF, and the lower bands, single numbers into the doubles, and then anything above 13 up to what was it, like 99?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, it was
that.
Pretty high, was UHF. And that's where you got a lot of the kind of public access, sketchy, cheap stuff, because it wasn't the best quality.
YouTube, kind of like before YouTube came around, right?
Yeah, it was. And But it was so much fun with the dial, because on VHF it was a nice big click, click, click. But UHF, there were so many channels that the it was so close together. It's just and that was a good way to get your dad to smack you, was to sit there scanning through the UHF back and forth.
And you always had like two dials, right? Like the big dial and then like a little internal dial or a separate dial where you could like fine tune between.
I remember that.
Because
nothing was exact. Nothing was exact.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Keep in mind, all these signals were analog, right? They were not digital, like what they are nowadays, right?
Just like,
and the difference between the two was the, if you want to get mathematical on it, right, is the logarithm of the wave, right? So the lower channels would have the bigger gaps in the wave, and then the upper channels would have the shorter gaps in the wave. That's how they would go from channel to channel.
And also, that you mentioned there's that dial to fine-tune it. The problem was the fine-tuning for one channel wasn't necessarily the fine-tuning for another channel. So you had to tune to that channel, tune it in, and then either stay there or go back to the other channel and probably have to retune it again.
And all of us remember that, you know, we would have our television over what they call, commonly call rabbit ears, which are just basically two antennas.
Wabbit ears.
Right. And so, and we all remember as kids, our some parent or some uncle or somebody saying, hey, grab that ear and just turn it down a little bit. Now stand there, because while you're holding it, you're actually a conductor and you make a better antenna.
And you pray, and at that moment you are praying, please don't change when I let go. Because if you let go and it gets bad, your job is now to stand next to the TV holding that thing
for the rest of the show,
whatever they're watching. And hopefully it's not like a football game. That's like, what, 4 hours that you're living there at the TV.
I got very creative with the aluminum foil. We were able to get it going without that. So that was what we ended up doing. So, but yeah, that, lots of kids had that job. Hold on to one end of that rabbit ears. Just keep holding. You're good. Go find. You can do something if you're standing there. Just you have to stand there.
I still do that somewhat, because like in my little Honda Civic, when talking AM radio, the antenna's up on the roof, like right by the driver. And there's some points where I'm driving and getting interference. I just have to reach out the window and I grab it. And it's usually when I'm driving along power lines and getting a lot of interference. But so that technique still works today. Mm-hmm. All right. And then I think the other one is the fact that TVs used to be furniture. Mm-hmm. Expensive furniture. Mm-hmm. And everybody started with that big console TV in the wooden cabinet. And eventually it would break. You would call out a TV. They actually had people that their whole job was to repair TVs.
TV repairmen.
You would call them. And if your TV was small enough, you would take it to them. But if it was too big, then they might come to your house for a fee. And everybody got to sit around and watch this guy dig in your TV and hopefully fix it. And then if it didn't, I was looking for a picture, that TV, you don't get rid of it. You throw a sheet or a tablecloth over it. It becomes a table, and you put the new TV on top.
Yep. Yeah, well, Jeff Foxworthy once said, if your working TV is sitting on top of your non-working TV, you might be a redneck.
No, see, that's not a might be redneck. You were just somebody from the 50s.
That was just you were just a normal person then.
It's normal.
Now, if that was now, then yes, maybe.
And remember, most people only had one TV.
Well, those
nowadays, there's so many screens in your house. How many screens are in your house? Everybody just really quickly in their head.
I'm looking at two right now. Third
there. If you count monitors and stuff, a lot. But if
I know.
TVs, just two. But the one thing that's that you have to remember is that these TVs were, they were huge, extraordinarily heavy, and very expensive.
And the screens were tiny.
Exactly, and very small. They were huge, but very small. So you would be looking at like a 20-inch screen if you had a really nice TV, and that would be in a box that was probably 40 or so inches across and probably about 3 feet tall or something, and it would weigh 200-plus pounds. So you would be, the reason you had a TV repairman is because you couldn't take that places. That was like moving a piano to take it in to get it repaired. And it was really expensive, like the cost of a piano. That's why people had one, because it was extremely expensive to get one. And that's why you would have somebody come repair it. Now, there's also the difference of the way they were built, right? They weren't a circuit board with circuits and
well, know, after like 1968.
Well, but they still were tube-based, right? So there were still a lot of pieces that could be easily. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
After 68 or early 70s is when they went to transistors and got away from the tubes.
But the picture tube was still a tube.
Oh, no, yeah. Absolutely. Picture
tube. Right. And that was one of the expensive pieces that could be replaced. And you could still keep salvage your TV by replacing that and keep the big the box and the other circuits and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's worth noting that those old TVs were robust. My dad, I think he still has the TV he watched as a kid in the 50s. The screen is about that big, right? And the console, I mean, it was pretty, but it was tall and skinny. But it's a piece. The thing is, up until recently, you could still turn it on and hear audio. It still worked. I mean, by 50, 60 years later, the tube is no longer functional, the cathode ray tube. But if you could still get an analog signal, which you can't, you would still be able to turn it on and at least listen to TV.
Yeah.
And that's the thing he used to watch, like, what, Howdy Doody and all that stuff in the 50s.
So the TV that I remember from my youth, I just linked in chat, as somebody actually has one for sale on eBay. This TV is, I believe, 19 inches, and it weighs a ton because I do believe it is cast iron around it. This thing is a beast of a TV. It was color Trinitron, a new technology. To give you a halfway decent display. It had a handle on top, so it was portable. And it has your two large dials. It was just, this was my TV that I ended up playing all my video games on. The Nintendo was on this guy. The Super Nintendo was on this guy for years. I played this TV. I'm sure it still worked when we got rid of it. But yes, it had those dials on it for you to adjust the tint and gent.
You know, so, it wasn't until I want to say 94 when I finally had a color TV in my bedroom. Up until that point, my TV was black and white because it was the TV that was hanging out in the garage and nobody yelled at me when I took it and put it in my room. But now you talk to my kids and they can't even grasp the concept of, number one, it's hard to understand that stuff wasn't recorded in color. And then also ever. And then there's also the fact that you would watch stuff that was recorded in color on a TV that couldn't reproduce color. Why? Because it was cheaper. Because color TVs were new. They still made black and white TVs until like the early 90s, which is the weird thing.
Do you guys remember the Victor Tube TVs?
No, I do not.
I might if I look one up.
I just put a link in the in the chat room there.
What is that thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
That was the first one I remember as a kid.
That's a step back before me, I guess.
Of course, it was old even when I was a kid.
Okay, right? But
was it next to the Victrola?
Yeah, it was my.
I grew up with a Victrola.
Okay,
that was the one that was haunted by the Indian. That's another story.
Yeah, but those were just black and white TVs. There, that one. No color.
Very cool.
All right, hey, are we gonna wrap up this walk down memory lane or anything else that we?
I just want to say, if there's anybody out there that has, you know, silly questions, feel free and email us or send us a tweet and ask us your question. We'd be happy to answer any more questions about old technology and how is it different than it is today. Be happy to talk.
We can't guarantee we won't laugh. That's okay. But we can guarantee after we finish laughing, we will do our best to give you a proper answer. I think that's a fair trade, right?
I think that's as best we can offer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Then I guess we should. Oh, I guess it's not working this week either.
No!
something, it might have got moved or something. I guess, so, rants and raves. Joke, mine, I let you down. All right, who's got rants, raves, just something you're kind of about? What's up?
I got a rave.
Go ahead.
Oh, sorry, Mike.
Do you need glow sticks and like EDM? not that kind of rave.
Yeah, well, maybe not that kind, right? But no, there's a show on Netflix called Ozark that I have finished watching actually, and excellent show. I would say it's along the line of a Breaking Bad, so to speak, and would recommend watching it. I think if you did enjoy Breaking Bad, you probably will enjoy this show too. Really liked it. Hope they have another season. But yeah, really enjoyed it.
It made me think of Arrested Development with consequences. But that's just because of Jason Bateman.
Right.
Well, I've been hearing things on and off about Ozark, that it's supposed to be very, very good. So, I don't know if it's the kind of show that I'll be watching, but it sounds like it'll be great. I suspect it'll get another season easily.
It was pretty good. I was a bit surprised in the fact that Netflix never tried to market it to me. I never once saw a commercial or a pop-up or anything until people had been talking about it, and it had been on for like a week. And I had to actually use the search feature on Netflix to find it. Because I think they talked about that on Cord Killers, that some people just aren't seeing it, which is weird because Netflix normally markets anything new to everybody. They don't care. They'll throw all your preferences out the window. Watch our new thing. I've been digging it. I took a break for a couple episodes, but I'm towards the end.
Yeah. Well, I've also been watching a show for the past little while. My wife and I have been we've gone through all of our regular shows, and there's no shows that we both like to want to watch together. So we said, okay, let's pick an old show that we hadn't seen in a while. And so she said, why don't we watch X-Files? I have never seen all of X-Files. I actually I picked up on it like the last couple seasons before the first movie came out. And I was like, oh, this actually looks like it could be good. I was actually enjoying it at that point. But at first, I really wasn't watching a lot of it. So we just got through almost the entire first season. And it's not bad. It holds up as a nice show. I've been very impressed with it. And also, it reminds you of a time back when seasons were 24 episodes long.
Only 24 because it had previously been 30.
So nowadays our what, 8 episode seasons
that drives me nuts,
13 or whatever.
Reruns.
So the reason why we wanted to watch it is because we actually were interested in watching the most recent season, since it's basically nearly rebooted. Mm-hmm. With this season 10, and there is going to be a season 11. But we went to Hulu, we went to everywhere else and said, hey, let's watch season 10, we'll catch up right there. And nope, can't find it, not available.
Watching season 10, a lot of people didn't like it. It was very rewarding, especially if you were into X-Files and you enjoyed the two X-Files movies for what they were, because season 10 basically picks up after the last movie and then just assumes that you understand certain things and then goes on a rampage, which I won't get into. That was very satisfying.
My
suggestion is when Mulder leaves the show and Robert Patrick joins, feel free to drop off. None of that stuff matters.
I believe that's when originally was watching. I was like, oh, I really don't like what's going on here.
The other recommendation I can make is, since you're watching through in order, Kumail Nanjiani did a podcast, or is still doing. It's called The X-Files Files, where they were doing a watch through, starting with episode 1. And due to the fact that he's a fairly up and coming actor guy, friends with Dan Harmon, he's been able to get people that were writers and producers and stuff on the show to come on and talk about the episodes, and including the guy that created the music. And it was, I found through the first season very entertaining, and I was watching along. But then Kumail lets his personal opinions of stuff moose a little too crazy, too often for my taste, and it just kind of made me start to dislike him as a person. but you know, if you're not sensitive to that kind of thing, then you know, which most people don't even notice it.
So I only have one thing to say so far about the first season of it, which is there is an episode where it seems like they hit Washington State every 3 or 4 episodes.
Well, they're based out of Virginia. Yeah. I get your state. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, they went out there because of Vancouver and
right.
Yeah,
but anyways, in one of the episodes, they're chasing after a truck and it ends up going to Mattawa, Washington. And all I have to tell you is that is not what Mattawa, Washington looks like. It's way off. Obviously, everybody thinks it's the Evergreen State. It's not. Sorry, guys, totally got that off. Got that wrong.
That was the same issue I had with Fargo. You know, previous seasons of Fargo taking place in Minnesota were fine because either they were in the 70s or like many years ago. This last season takes place like while I was living here. And I could tell you, okay, now definitely everything about this show is wrong. And the one glaring thing they didn't even bother trying to fix is every time they're driving around, all the signals are sideways. There are no sideways signals in Minnesota. This is obviously filmed in Canada. Yeah, you could have at least avoided showing signals.
Oh, well.
The reason they get up to Washington State so much, as Clyde's indicating, is that it was filmed in Vancouver, B.C.
Yeah.
Right. So it's pretty easy analog to say, hey, we're in Washington State.
Vancouver is simply northern Washington State, and we're southern British Columbia, so yeah. It makes sense.
Well, there's a Vancouver on both sides of the border, right?
No, there's a Vancouver on the very, very, very close to our side of close to us, our northern border, and then we have a Vancouver, but it's very close to Portland, Oregon. So
I meant. There's a Vancouver on both sides of the border. Meaning yes, we have one, they have one.
When you say you go into, I'm going to Vancouver and you're in Seattle, like, which one? You're going north or you're going south.
All right. Rock on. Yeah, but no, check out X-Files Files. If you got the first season fresh in your mind, then you may be able to just listen through. And it's Kumail and his wife do the podcast together. It's pretty good. All right.
Anybody else?
All right. Mine, you know, I am not watching a lot of shows right now. So when it comes to rants and raves, it's a little hard. The only show I've really been able to get on from like TV type shows is American Ninja Warrior, which we of course love. I've mentioned that in the past. What I am watching is a lot of podcasts. I think I mentioned Critical Role a couple of weeks ago. And if I didn't, then Critical Role. Then the other one that I just started watching a day or so ago is Matt Colville's Running the Game, which obviously I've been kind of paying a lot of attention to D&D lately. Got a friend that kind of got me back into it and playing some games with a couple of old friends. And so that's a lot of fun. And Matthew Colville's Running the Game is a great podcast telling you how to run D&D games. And they're quick, you know, usually about 10 minutes. Sometimes they stretch out to about 20 minutes per episode. He's got like 40 episodes up now. He's really insightful, really interesting, and really humorous. So if you are at all interested in D&D, especially if you're interested in running D&D campaigns, then check out his podcast. And if you played when you were a kid, you might consider playing it again if you can find the time.
Yeah, just don't play in the campaign that's currently going on at Wednesday nights at 9 o'clock on a different stream with some other people we won't name traitors.
So
You can always go back and watch their campaign later. That's all I'm saying. Definitely go check it out later.
Fill me in. I'm not aware.
Oh, Dark Redeemer and Jay Brushwood and Mike TV. They're doing a. I don't know what it is. I don't know the difference between all the different types, but they're doing some sort of a campaign. I think Mike TV is actually DMing. So it sounds really interesting. It's on their Twitch channel. It should be happening right now. So you could probably pop over there and see what's going on after the fact.
Cool. Sounds good.
Yeah. I had something I was going to rant about, but I don't remember what it was. And so whatever. you guys can rant about the fact that I wasn't salty enough, and that's fine. So I should probably just wrap this up. I want to thank everybody that came out to the chat room to participate. Thank you so much. You make this worth doing. So we're not just talking to each other, because, I mean, we could just talk to each other.
Yeah,
you know?
We could.
That's whatever. But, yeah, this weekend we will be having the August movie party. And it is spider-themed, so we will be watching Big Ass Spider. I will not say why it's spider themed at this point because I was told not to, but tune in on Saturday and maybe we'll find out. But yeah, Big Ass Spider, potentially a second one of some sort. If you have a good spider movie that is not Lobalantula or Lobalantula 2, definitely let us know. I found out that Lobalantula stars Steve Guttenberg from Police Academy. Steve Guttenberg. And I was like, oh, now I have to watch this. And then I found out there's a second one. Holy crap. And he stars in both of them. They were made for TV, so they're going to be short because of room for commercials. So that I think we need to save those for a night where we can watch both of them. Because I want to see... Steve Guttenberg fight lava spiders, tarantulas from volcano or whatever it is. But yeah, no, coming out right here on Diamond Club TV. This may, depending on what happens with the way that we transition DCTV, this may be the last one, last movie party in its current format. We may have to redesign and figure out a different way to do it. So definitely come on out 9 p.m. Central. This Saturday, August 5th, here on Diamond Club TV. Follow that at DC Movie Party for information. Ask questions, all that jazz. For us, we are here every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Central on Diamond Club TV. If you want to watch us after the fact, catch up on past episodes, or, you know, go back and find stuff that came out of our own mouths to prove us wrong, perfectly acceptable. You can find all that out on YouTube. Just search for the VOD Squad. If you haven't, make sure that you click like and subscribe and please, all of those normal etiquette things that you do out of habit for your friends. We appreciate it. And guys, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and I will check you guys later.
Bye, guys.
Bye.